Hi, I'm Lynette Pearson with the League of Women Voters. The League is a nonpartisan organization that has provided voters with unbiased election information since 1920. We've invited candidates to talk with us so that you can learn more about them. Joining us now is Mark Woodard, candidate for Tigard Mayor. Welcome, Mark.
Thank you. Happy to be here.
Thank you for coming. Just to get started, could you tell us a little bit about your background and why you're running for Tigard Mayor?
Well, it's kind of like my father and my grandfather before him, second mayor of Tigard. My father was very instrumental in the community, like his dad. My grandfather was known as for the people, and my father was as well. And I would like to be part of keeping the community engaged in community outreach to get their support. I just want to make sure that it remains a place people want to live, work, play, and spend their leisurely time.
Well, thank you. First real question we have, local government is the first tier for building livable communities. Why have you chosen to run for mayor?
Well, I've been on city council 8 years. I've decided to run for mayor because I want to then again make sure that our community stays a livable place, an affordable place, that it continues to have sustainable city services, and that we take care of everyone. And the only way to do that, I go back to that outreach and community engagement. It's important that we do that right to make sure we get that input and ensure we build and develop a place people then again want to remain and age in place.
And what would you do to reach out to the community and engage more people?
Well, I think what I've been a champion at is I set a goal in 2012 as a city recreation goal, realizing at that time that you know you could get a lot of people to engage in a city hall depending on when you can get them there. Sometimes that's a little bit difficult. But what I found out through city recreation, when you incorporate events and within the tourism industry and you can bring people together in mass, you're more apt to get their support for city goals that you set as priorities. They also are really good at telling you what they need and what they don't need and what they want and what they don't want. So I think it's really important that we look at city recreation like competing cities that have city recreation and look more towards events like our city streets, or excuse me, our streets fair and our 4th of July. I mean, that brings masses to the table. There's huge opportunity for outreach and civic engagement. And we have yet to tap that. And I think if we want to retain people in the city of Tigard, we want them to work together, we need that feedback and we need to provide those opportunities for families that build also everlasting memories for those families. And not to mention the opportunities for small business and economic development. Economic development was the second goal I set in the city when I first came on board. That was a 2013. So small business opportunity, we got to watch out for the small business. We also need to take care of those folks, those hardworking folks in their homes and people on fixed incomes. And there's ways to do that, but we just need to get creative, think more business-like. I've got a business background and I'm a little bit different in that regard.
All right. What are the most critical issues facing the community at this time? Could you tell us about your top two priorities?
Well, the first one has to be traffic congestion. We've had an attitude surveys done biannually, and that typically falls as the number one issue. And I think to resolve that, we need to look at prioritizing street circulation priorities and set those as goals. So in other words, maybe you pick the Hall Boulevard McDonald intersection to work on that 1 year. Maybe the second year you set as a goal the Durham Street 72nd intersection, and you start picking at them, and you start looking for the support from your transportation jurisdictional authorities, and you work with them to bring in as much matching dollars as you can. We haven't done that. We've focused on a lot of other things in the way of planning for our future development. I think we need to go back to the basics and do that. The other one would be enhanced busing. There's a huge underserved community that we need to address now. We can't depend on the fact of whether or not the Southwest Corridor Rail project will be voted in by the region, whether that will happen or not. We need to start being proactive right now. And those, in my opinion, are the two things we need to focus on with regard to traffic congestion. The second thing that's really important is affordability. And what happened is most people know in the mid-90s, Measure 50 reset the assessed value of properties at disparaging rates. Mm-hmm. Everybody, you know, everybody pays a different property tax, which is just unreal. My next door neighbor could be paying $1,000 more a year than I am, or I could be paying more than they are. And it's created a huge problem, especially those on fixed incomes and hardworking families. So we need to find a way to tax reform neutralize that. And I know it's a big challenge, but I think we need to work with the League of Cities, and we also need to work with our state representatives and let them know that, hey, I'm willing to tackle those things. I'm willing to help find solutions for those things. I understand that problem, and I can help resolve it. I believe I can do that.
Okay. So affordability and traffic congestion are your top two concerns. Moving on, although city council positions are nonpartisan, there are usually partisan views represented. What is your philosophy on bridging the political divide and using compromise when necessary?
Yes. Well, I was out doing door hangers the other day for mm-hmm. my campaign, and one gal asked me, she says, basically ask me a partisan question. My answer to her is my philosophy is not to take a partisan position, but mm-hmm. to actually, I would like to see the city take more of a facilitation role in that. So when you get that outreach and that community engagement, you bring them to the plate. You get that commitment, you bring them to the plate, you let them tell you what's on their mind. Are you doing things right? Do you need to shift gears? Then again, we go back to operating more business-like. We need to have a way to better capture information based on oversight. And that oversight can come by way of a bunch of different feedback mechanisms. So my position is a nonpartisan approach. I'm a team builder. I like to resolve problems with community input mm-hmm. and take the best of those ideas and, if possible, work for the majority's needs. It's not about wants. You know, we have to make that separation, needs and wants. I know you want this, but if you can come together and you can bring enough people together, you can take out the special interests. Mm-hmm. I don't cater to special interests. I didn't take any endorsements from special interests. I don't even have any endorsements from people that would be connected to those types of things. I'm working for my community. As my slogan goes, I'm putting Tigard people first. And that simply means is we need to look at resolving our issues. If we can't take care of our issues, we can't help the disparaged. Right. If we can't financially afford it, we can't help anybody else. So let's focus on what we need first and then move forward.
Okay, all right. How is your town perceived by your residents and neighboring towns, and which areas would you like to change?
Well, the town is perceived as a nice place to live. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, the other flip of it, which I mentioned, is the affordability issue. A lot of people feel that they can't afford to live here. You know, our kids are growing up and they're being decentralized from their parents. You know, I would say that the other part of that question is, could you read that one more time just so I get the
sure.
full?
Which areas would you like to see change or improve in our last minute here?
Yeah. I don't believe if we can't find a way to outreach and engage the community to bring them together, we can accomplish all the things that we could be, all the great things the city of Tigard could be. Mm-hmm. We can't get there. And that's why I've been such a staunch advocate for city recreation. I'm even willing to give up $34,000 of the mayor's stipend to throw in there to get matching funds to make sure that we keep that city recreation program going at a minimum, even though we have tight budget constraints, mm-hmm. realizing with a $100,000 investment, just keeping that coordination alive and that outreach and that engagement possible, that we provide the social, political, economic multipliers that we wouldn't gain otherwise. Why the city of Tigard doesn't value city recreation in a lot of ways, you know, from different interests and see those benefits, I have yet to understand, but I know it's gaining traction.
Yeah.
So that would be the one thing I would say that needs to stay in play. And then again, it's going to help our small business. One last thing I wanted to say is I didn't talk about the city performance audits. I was a champion for that since 2011. I want to say really quick that ballot measure 34-283 failed. I was a no vote, the only no vote on that, because I've known since 2011 that without public oversight, and we couldn't get the oversight mechanisms in place to support such a measure that would increase city taxes 47%. So I knew that way back then. Unfortunately, I wasn't successful at selling it to the rest of the council. It went through and failed miserably. We need to do things differently. And as of June of this year, city council recommended highly that we start city performance audits. We do it now with that failure to prove that when we ask, we can prove that we are doing our spending efficiently and they can trust us. So that was a big win. So I've always been about, I don't buckle. I have the courage it takes to lead. I have a military background, 20 years, retired out of the military. I'm the longest serving counselor. I don't buckle, I lead, I don't follow. And one last thing I'd like to say, if I have the time, is if the person running for mayor can't commit 25 to 30 hours to the position because they work a full-time job, they're not gonna lead effectively because that's what it takes. I can do that, I work for myself. There's some others that may not be able to do that. And that's a big deal. So you're either leading or you're following.
All right.
I will lead.
Well, thank you very much. We appreciate you coming by today. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.